This is a story about creation, not the creation of the universe, nor the creation of the stars, not the creation of the solar system, nor even of planet Earth, but the creation of a nation through one single man whose remarkable destiny was to father a nation of people, which was to serve a very special purpose, planned from the beginning of time by Jehovah, the Lord of creation, to fulfill his plan for the establishment of his promised kingdom on earth. Biblical archaeologist and research historian. Of such paramount importance was the man Abraham, that all of 15 chapters of scripture are devoted to his history and that of his descendants. He lived in or near a town called Ur, in a well-watered agricultural area that the Bible calls Chaldea. In those days, cultivated land and fields of grain stretched as far as the horizon. But today, Chaldea, now southern Iraq, is only desert, dust, and sand. Those ancient fertile fields long since gone. Abram's town stood close to the great river Euphrates, and further to the east, the mighty river Tigris. At the time of our story, Abram was 90 years old, and his wife Sarai, later to be renamed Sarah, was about the same age. They had no children, had long since given up any idea of having any. Abram was in reality a wealthy cattle rancher, but lived life as does a modern Bedouin, moving from place to place in search of fresh grazing for his extensive herds. But Abram's peaceful lifestyle was to change, and change dramatically, for he had received instructions from God to leave the area and migrate northward to a town called Haran in present-day Syria. Here Almighty God came to Abram in a vision and said,
I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed.
So along with all his family and flocks, Abram trekked from Haran southward into the land of Canaan, later to be known as Palestine. There can be no doubt that Abram was indeed a very specially chosen, for few have had the great privilege of conversing with the Almighty as had Abram. Some years later, God again spake with Abram and said, I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed be numbered. But Abram complained that he and his wife were old, and he had no seed. Thus God said,
Look now toward heaven, and tell the stars if thou be able to number them. So shall thy seed be.
And God spoke again and said,
As for me, my covenant is with thee. Thou shalt be called a father of many nations, neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be Abraham. For a father of many nations have I made thee, and kings shall come out of thee. And I will establish my covenant between me and thee, and thy seed after thee, for an everlasting covenant.
So here, recorded in the scriptures, is the birth of a new nation of people from one devout man, who, although meticulous in obeying the commandments of the Lord, even to the sacrifice of his own son, though this was halted by God at the last moment, was yet human enough to doubt certain aspects of God's revelation to him. Abraham's wife, Sarai, is described in the Bible as being an outstandingly beautiful woman. Indeed, she made quite a stir when she was presented at Pharaoh's court. But later, when she overheard the angel's message to Abraham that she was to have a child, Sarah laughed to herself in disbelief. Although she was far past the age for childbearing, God promised Abraham that she would indeed have a child, that afterwards she would have her name changed from Sarai to Sarah. For as God said to Abraham, Sarah shall be a mother of nations. Abraham's skepticism was so obvious, he and his wife being in their 90s, that God gently chides him and says, Is anything too hard for the Lord? Some years earlier, because she was too old to bear children, Sarah, in accordance with the customs of that time in the Middle East, had given her handmaid Hagar, an Egyptian girl, to her husband, in the hope that she might provide a male heir that Abraham so desired. In due time, Hagar conceived and presented Abraham with a son, whom they called Ishmael. Ishmael was to be the ancestor of 12 princes, and from whom are descended the Arab nations of today. However, God's promises were not with Ishmael, but with Abraham and Sarah's miracle child, Isaac. When Isaac had grown into manhood and was ready for marriage, Abraham made it very clear to him that he was not ever to marry into the Canaanite element in order to keep the bloodline clear of contamination. So Abraham sent his chief steward to his distant relatives to find a wife for Isaac. And he came across a young girl drawing water for her father's flocks. Her name was Rebekah, and the Bible describes her as being very fair to look upon. As soon as Isaac saw Rebekah, it was love at first sight, and soon they were married. When eventually Rebekah became pregnant, she found that there was much strange movement within her. And scripture says she inquired of the Lord. There came a strange and ominous answer from God. Two nations are within thy womb, and two manner of peoples shall be separated. Rebekah gave birth to two boys, Esau and Jacob. But even before their birth, they struggled with each other and were at enmity. And so it has continued even up to this present day. Esau was born only minutes before Jacob, and thus should have received the birthright. But God's plan for the development of his nation was to be through Isaac's son Jacob. Perhaps through divine foreknowledge, God knew that Esau was going to marry Canaanite women, which was clearly in disobedience to God's law for his people. Unaware of his destiny, Jacob, with the assistance of his mother, Rebekah, contrived to trick his aged father into bestowing the birthright upon himself. In those far-off days, once a paternal blessing had been given, it could not be revoked or passed to another. Isaac was then well past 100 years of age and had become feeble and blind. He had apparently forgotten God's promise that the younger son was to receive the blessing. But Rebekah had not forgotten. And when overhearing Isaac planning to bless Esau, ordered a reluctant Jacob to deceive his father by posing as Esau, who was away hunting. Rebekah, fearful that Esau would receive the blessings, felt that she must help God out. thus conceived this plan that she and Jacob then put into practice. Blinded, perhaps, by mother's love for her favorite son, perhaps she momentarily forgot that the Almighty needed no help from her. Or maybe she felt that she was stopping her husband from disobeying God. When Esau found out that he had been cheated, he threatened to kill Jacob, who fled for his life. Only many years later did the two brothers meet in somewhat happier circumstances. One might be inclined to sympathize with Esau on account of Jacob's double dealings. Yet despite this weakness of character, it was to be from Jacob that this special nation was to descend. Jacob, now isolated from his family home, on a journey from Beersheba to Haran, on a long trek through rugged country, lay down to sleep in the open, resting his head on a convenient stone for a pillar. He had the strangest of dreams. The book of Genesis tells the story.
And he dreamed. And behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God ascending and descending upon it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham thy father, and the God of Isaac. The land whereon thou liest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed. And thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth. And thou shalt spread abroad to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south. And in thee, and in thy seed, shall all the families of the earth be blessed.
Stunned by this amazing revelation, Jacob set his pillow stone upright, and as was the custom, poured oil over it as an act of sanctification, and said, This stone which I have set up for a pillar shall be the house of God. And he named the place Bethel. There are many who believe, and there is much evidence to support this belief, that the very same stone which Jacob anointed in Palestine is one and the same with the famous Stone of Destiny, which remained for hundreds of years beneath the coronation chair in Westminster Abbey in London. On this stone, British kings and queens have been crowned for many generations. This stone has a very ancient history. It is believed to have been brought away from Jerusalem by the prophet Jeremiah in the face of the advancing Babylonians, who captured and sacked the city. It was taken via Egypt to Ireland, thence to Scotland, and finally to England. Since the coronation of Queen Elizabeth II, it has been returned to Scotland and now resides in Edinburgh Castle, from whence the Scots allow it to be returned to Westminster Abbey in London for any future royal coronation. Jacob's dream of the heavenly ladder was not the only strange experience he had. The book of Genesis tells of him wrestling all night long with an angelic being. Now, whether this story is allegorical or factual, we don't know. But the result was that God changed Jacob's name to Israel, meaning a prince with God, or a ruler with God. Finally, Jacob arrived at his uncle's ranch at Haran, where he immediately falls in love with the younger of Laban's two daughters, Rachel. In time, Jacob marries both girls and raises a great family of 12 sons and one daughter. Surely that one daughter, Dinah, must have made her brothers fetch and carry for her. One day, an incident took place in Jacob's family life that was to have major consequences. His son Joseph was a visionary, a dreamer, and on one occasion, after one of his strange dreams, he told his brothers about it, rather unwisely, that he had seen them in his dream bowing down before him. Nothing could have made him more unpopular. In his dreams, even his brother's sheaves of wheat bowed before him. Even his father reproved him. In the brothers' understandable anger and jealousy, they sold Joseph to a passing band of Ishmaelites. They faked Joseph's death by wild animals and showed his blood-stained coat to old Israel, who was distraught with grief at the death of his favorite son. And so many more years passed, and Joseph eventually rose to very high rank in Pharaoh's court. He was made Egypt's first minister. Famine was a frequent and unwelcome event in the Middle East, and still is today, and Israel's clan were forced to go down into Egypt to buy grain. To the brothers' amazement and considerable discomfiture, they found that their younger brother Joseph was now prime minister of Egypt. And in fear and apprehension, they fell on their knees before him, just as Joseph had foreseen in his dreams long ago. One can imagine old Israel's great joy, his favorite son found, and in a very high office. And at Joseph's insistence, the whole of Israel's family left Palestine to settle, one may be sure, in a very choice spot near the city of Ramesses. Old Israel lived a further 15 years in Egypt, but being aware that his end was near, called his sons to him to bestow the patriarchal blessings on them, this being a custom in those days. To Joseph he gave the firstborn portion. Then he blessed Joseph's two sons born in Egypt, Ephraim and Manasseh, saying, "Let my name be placed on them." Thus they both received the honorary name of Israel. In this Dutch painting, Jacob places his right hand on the head of the younger boy, Ephraim, instead of where it should have been on Manasseh, the elder. Joseph objected, imagining that the old man had made a mistake. But Israel confirmed his action, saying, "Manasseh shall be a great nation, but the younger brother shall be greater, and his seed shall become a multitude of nations." The story of the nation of Israel's sojourn in Egypt for about 400 years and their time of slave labor under successive pharaohs is well known, as is their dramatic escape from bondage in Egypt under the leadership of Moses. The hardships they encountered in the desert only served to toughen them into a strong, fighting people that swept all before them in their first invasion of the land of Canaan. Israel was officially formed into a kingdom in 1020 BC by the prophet Samuel. And when the people clamored for a visible king to be like the surrounding nations, Samuel anointed Saul to be king over Israel. Although he defeated many of Israel's enemies, King Saul proved less of a decisive ruler than Samuel had hoped. Then there appeared in the story of Israel the young shepherd David. Saul was the people's choice, but David was God's choice, and he is anointed king over Israel by the prophet Samuel. Although often depicted as a little boy, David must have been well over 6 feet tall, as he was able to wear Saul's own armor. And Saul, as the Bible says, stood head and shoulders over the men of Israel. However, Saul's armor was too restrictive for David, and he politely refused it, and after felling the Philistine hero with a single slingshot, slew him with the giant's own sword, all of which stood him well with the people of Israel. Saul came to a humiliating end on Mount Gibeah, when he committed suicide there, accompanied by his faithful armor-bearer. David's reign over Israel was one of continuous successes against the surrounding nations. But in his later years, even David strayed from the path God would have had him take. His illicit affair with a beautiful Bathsheba earned him strong reproof from God's prophets. David was followed on the throne of Israel by his son Solomon, whose wisdom and leadership made the kingdom of Israel the most powerful and wealthiest nation in the Middle East at that time. So famous was Solomon that royalty from far distant countries came to see him, such as the Queen of Sheba, Her country was the present-day Yemen. However, total power invariably corrupts. And as the Bible records, Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord in the latter days of his reign. Solomon's fame and power proved irresistible to too many foreign women, and their admiration turned him from the true path of righteousness. He allowed them to sacrifice to their own pagan gods, neglecting the worship of the one true God of Israel. These are some of the household gods excavated in Palestine, dated of the time of Solomon. Moloch was one of the heathen gods of the Ammonites, and some of the people of Israel went so far as to even sacrifice their own children to this evil fire god. Thus far had Israel departed from the Lord, and his words to Solomon were grim in the extreme.
Forasmuch as thou hast not kept my covenant and my statutes which I have commanded thee, I will surely rend the kingdom from thee.
On the death of Solomon, his son Rehoboam ascended the throne. His very first act was to call all Israel to him at Shechem, of which little now remains but these ruins, to ratify his succession to the throne. Jeroboam, who had been a labor foreman under Solomon, asked the young king Rehoboam for assurances that the burden of heavy taxation would be made lighter. Northern Israel's demand was no taxation without representation. But this demand was angrily rejected. From this moment, the nation of Israel was divided into two separate kingdoms, the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. 10 of the 12 tribes refused to accept Rehoboam as king and elected Jeroboam, their spokesman, then crowned him king, who made his capital city Samaria, now a ruin, in the northern part of Israel. But two of the tribes accepted Rehoboam as their ruler and continued to live in and around Jerusalem. And together with the small tribe of Benjamin, formed the southern kingdom of Judah. This is how the city would have looked at that time. The northern kingdom acquired the ancient Canaanite city fortress of Megiddo, where the people departed even further from the law of the Lord. To the distress of many of Israel's holy men, they allied themselves with the worship of Baal, Dagon, Ashtoreth, the mother goddess of Baal. Prophet after prophet warned Israel of the dire consequences of this idol worship, but these warnings fell on deaf ears. "We are weary of your warnings," said the people, and little by little, the morals of this once great nation began to deteriorate. And it was at this time that the prophet Elijah had a great and successful confrontation with the priests of Baal. And Israel once again returned to the Lord's way, for a time. But only too soon, Israel returned to its old evil ways of idol worship. And a grim warning was issued by the prophet Ahijah to the house of Jeroboam.
"You have made yourselves other gods to provoke me to anger. Therefore, behold, I will bring evil upon the house of Jeroboam, and will utterly sweep away the house of Jeroboam as a man sweeps away dung."
Yet it was not only Jeroboam's reign that was to come to a violent end. An even more grim prophecy foresaw Israel's end in Palestine by the Assyrian army by way of Elijah's stark warning.
"Henceforth the Lord will smite Israel as a reed is shaken in the water, and will root up Israel out of this good land which he gave to their fathers. And he will scatter them beyond the river Euphrates, because they have made their idolatrous symbols, provoking the Lord to anger."
Time after time, Israel was warned about their evil ways. Hosea was another prophet in the 8th century B.C. who foresaw the ultimate fate of the nation. He wrote,
"And now they sin more and more, and make for themselves molten images, idols skillfully made of silver. They sacrifice to these."
In disgust, the prophet Hosea wrote,
"Men kiss calves. Therefore they shall be like the morning mist, or like the dew that goes early away, like the chaff that swells from the threshing floor."
These heathen altars were discovered at Byblos on the Lebanon coast, and although not in Israel's own territory, they are similar to many put up in Israel's northern kingdom. and were a source of great distress to Israel's men of God. So despite the continual warnings from the prophets of Israel, the people had strayed far from the original concept of a special nation chosen by the Almighty to serve his purposes. Thus he used the Assyrians as a rod of chastisement for a long period of time. And he used other nations as well. This period is called in the Bible the seven times punishment, which was the last 2,520 years, a period which ended about 200 years ago.
And the heathen shall know that the house of Israel went into captivity for their iniquity, because they trespassed against me. Therefore I hid my face from them, and gave them into the hand of their enemies. So fell they all by the sword.
So the Assyrians came down like a wolf in the fold, and easily overran the armies of northern Israel. And many thousands were carried away into Syria as slave labor, and to act as buffer states on Assyria's borders against outside enemies. This invasion of Israel had a double purpose. For Assyria had long cast covetous eyes on the riches of Egypt, and only the now divided nation of Israel stood in their way, a nation now weakened and easy to plunder. The first deportation of Israel from Palestine came in 745 B.C., when Tiglath-pileser, or King Pul as the Bible calls him, led his army south and conquered much of the northern Israel and most of the tribe of Manasseh, whose territory was on the east side of the River Jordan. The second book of Kings recorded that the army of Assyria transported large numbers of northern Israel as captives to Halah and Habor and the Gozan area. The exact location of Habor is unknown, but Tel Halah, which existed as far back as 1500 B.C., could well be the Halah of the Bible. Gozan could be the modern river Guzana, a small tributary of the Euphrates. Northern Israel was not only transported into what is now Syria, but also much further to the east, to Media, a country between the Caspian Sea and the Persian Gulf. Tiglath-pileser would have been surprised had he been told that his military conquests, recorded on clay tablets, would end up in the British Museum 2,500 years later. These tablets are part of the Royal Assyrian Annals and State. I received tribute from Menahem of Samaria. Like a lone bird he fled, then submitted to me. By this time, much of Israel's territory was under Assyrian domination. Israel was now a conquered people. The prophet's visions were now concrete reality. On his return from his attack on Egypt, the Assyrian king Sennacherib besieged the Israelite city of Lachish. This is part of its ruins. In his attack, he used the latest mechanized machines of war, such as siege towers and armored battering rams. His treatment of captured Israelites was cruel in the extreme. Sennacherib's account correlates Bible history in the Book of Kings, which states, "And as for Hezekiah the Judean, who did not submit to my yoke, 48 of his strong walled cities I besieged and took, 200,150 people, male and female, horses, mules, asses, camels, cattle and sheep without number. I brought away with them and counted them as spoil. Himself, like a caged bird, I shut up in Jerusalem, his royal city." What Sennacherib neglected to report was, he was unable to capture the city of Jerusalem itself. Mass deportation of populations was a common event in the centuries before Christ, as can be shown from tablets found in the ruins of Sargon II's palace, which stated, "I set siege to and conquered Samaria. I carried away into captivity 27,290 persons who lived there." Although this number would seem to indicate that only a portion of northern Israel was removed, Sargon stated in another inscription that he had taken all the people. This discrepancy was caused by Esar Haddon, who methodically defaced Sargon's deportation inscriptions. Thus, after 200 eventful years, the once great and powerful kingdom of Israel came to its end in 721 BC, the majority of its people having been carried away captive into Assyria and Media to become known as the Lost Tribes of Israel. For apparently, these vast numbers of people had vanished from off the face of the earth. According to Josephus,
there are but two tribes in Asia and Europe subject to the Romans, while the 10 tribes are beyond the river Euphrates, an immense multitude, not to be estimated by numbers.
When Assyria in its turn fell to the now powerful forces of Babylon in 612 BC, it gave no comfort to the city of Jerusalem. And indeed, the Babylonians captured and sacked the city of Jerusalem in 586 BC. Most of the remaining inhabitants, together with King Zedekiah and the royal house of Judah, were all taken captive to Babylon, thus fulfilling God's warning to them, as recorded in the book of Leviticus, that they would receive the same treatment as the northern kingdom, which was already in exile. Eventually, Babylon itself fell to the Persians, and today is a ruin, a curiosity for passing visitors to see. After being held captive in Babylon for about 70 years, Cyrus the Persian, who had defeated the Babylonians, allowed the Judeans to return to their homeland, as recorded on this clay cylinder. While a few who enjoyed the life in Babylon stayed there, the vast majority in groups and families moved way up northwest up the course of the river Euphrates and never returned to Jerusalem. You will note now that the vast majority of both Israel and Judah are exiles in Assyrian territory, and no doubt many of those leaving Babylon will have joined them. Josephus the historian records some interesting facts about those of Israel who decided to return to Jerusalem. Only some 49,000 out of the original 600,000 people taken captive to Babylon actually returned. And with these expatriarchs came some Babylonians. Together with the Edomite element already in the city of Jerusalem, these mixed peoples became known as the Nation of the Jews, a name not having been applied to any part of the Hebrew nation prior to the Babylonian captivity. Josephus also records that the returning Judeans brought back with them some of the Babylonian customs and religious rites. This would explain why Jesus bitterly criticized the Jerusalem priesthood for allowing Babylonian traditions to pollute the Mosaic law. The Jewish theologian Dr. H. Gretz, in his History of the Jews, writes, "The Babylonian, rather than the Jerusalem Talmud, became the fundamental possession of the Jewish race, its life breath, its very soul." In other words, the Judean Israelites returned from Babylon, marked the end of Hebrewism and its ties with the Old Testament, and the beginning of Judaism, which today is erroneously linked with Christianity. Jerusalem was now populated with multiracial people at the time when work started on the rebuilding of the city walls and the temple, but not without many intergroup altercations and disharmony. While the rebuilding of the city continued, the vast majority of the nation of Israel, both the northern and southern kingdoms of Israel, once the richest and most powerful of the nations of the Middle East, remained in captivity and servitude. Was this to be the final chapter in a people once chosen by Almighty God for his special purposes here on earth? Had God made a mistake in choosing Israel? And if they were a specially chosen people for a task, how was it that they seemingly vanished from sight into obscurity? Lost to the uncaring world, maybe, but not to God. The Almighty knew Israel's past, present, and future, and did her pre-planned destiny. Overlooked by many of today's theologians, the so-called minor prophets, Hosea and Amos, foretold the captivities of Israel, but also prophesied that they would not remain lost, but would eventually be restored as a nation. If secular historians have found no mention of Israel in ancient records, the reason is very simple. Their various captors did not call them by their original name, but devised their own names for them. One example of this can be seen in the Assyrian gallery in the British Museum. This is the black obelisk of Shalmaneser III of Assyria. On one section of the obelisk is a pictograph of King Jehu of Israel paying tribute to Shalmaneser. And the inscription reads, "The tribute of Eliab of Beth Khumri." That is, the tribute of Jehu of the house of Omri. Omri was one of the kings of northern Israel, and the Assyrians knew them as Beth Khumri, or house of Omri. Although the Assyrians continued to call captive Israel by this name, Israel continued to call themselves by their old and ancient name, Beth Isaac, or House of Isaac. This name is also well known to the Assyrians, but they rendered it Iskasa, or Sakasini, Saka from Isaac, or Isaac's sons. We know the word today as Saxon. Since the scriptures state that captive Israel would not remain lost forever, I will repeat the question, what happened to them? Our first clues as to the ultimate fate of dispersed Israel was found by archaeologists excavating the ruins of Sargon II's royal palace at Nineveh. They were in the form of cuneiform tablets and were uncovered about a century ago. They were translated by Professor Waterman of Michigan University, but their relevance to Israel was completely overlooked at that time, owing to their complete disorder, lying as they were among some 1,400 other texts. One tablet dated 707 BC referred to a people called Gimira who were living in an area into which Israel had been placed by the Assyrians earlier. The name Gimira is evidently a corruption of Assyria's name for Israel, Khumri. The tablets were reports from an Assyrian frontier post, reports which were forwarded to the king, and which stated that the forces of Urartu, that is, Ararat, enemies of Assyria, were mounting an invasion south of Lake Urmia in Media, an area where captive Israel had been placed. The report read, "When the king of Urartu came into the land of Gimira, his army was routed." Routed, obviously, by the local inhabitants, the Khumri or Gimira. So now we note that Israel, far from being a cowed or captive people, were beginning to assert themselves. The report also stated that these Gimira, as they were then called, made a counterattack, invaded Urartu, and captured all their military commanders. These cuneiform tablets not only confirmed the findings of the various archaeological excavations, but they also identified the people who were responsible and where they came from. Another and later report stated that in the second year of the Assyrian king Esarhaddon, 670 BC, a sizable number of the Gimira rose in rebellion under their leader, Tuespa. And when the Assyrian army pursued them, they retreated westward, and although some were captured, the bulk of the people migrated westward, the vanguard of Israel's movement toward the west. So militarized had Israel now become that they invaded Lydia in Asia Minor and captured the town of Sardis in around 615 BC, and again in 600. However, settlement here was not to be. Later, they met their match in Gyges, king of Lydia, who forced Israel north, out of Asia Minor toward the Black Sea coast. Many of Israel crossed the Black Sea and settled in the Crimea, where there are gravestones with Hebrew biblical names on them. Most, however, encircled the coastlands and arrived in the area which is now the Ukraine. Quoting from the book of Esdras,
"And whereas thou sawest that he gathered another peaceable multitude to him, these are the 10 tribes which were carried away prisoners out of their own land in the time of Uzziah the king, whom Shalmaneser, the king of Assyria, led away captive. And he carried them over the waters, that is, the river Euphrates, and so they came into another land. But they took this counsel among themselves that they would leave the multitude of the heathen and go forth into another country where never mankind dwelt, that they might there keep their statute which they never kept in their own land. and they entered into Euphrates by the narrow passages of the river. For the Most High then showed them signs and held still the flood till they were passed over. For through that country there was a great way to go, namely of a year and a half. And the same region is called Arsereth.
Arsereth is the region just to the west of the Black Sea. Israel had entered Europe. The Greeks were aware of these newcomers to Europe and called them Cimmerioi, Cimmerians in English. The Roman name Cimbri and the word Celt are both derivatives of Cimmerian. After the forces of Babylon had conquered the once great Assyrian Empire, they then invaded that part of Media that Gimira, who had not escaped, had settled. Pushed on northwest by the Babylonians, they headed for the Caucasus Mountains, the Darial Pass, and into the area of South Russia, then called Scythia. It is interesting to note that this pass through the Caucasus is still called the Pass of the Israelites. The Syrians called the Gimira Iskuzi, or House of Isaac. The Persians, on the other hand, called them Saka. The Greeks called them Scuths, or Scythians. All these names have the same basic root form, SK, which are all derivatives of Isaac. Different names, but one people. Beside the ancient trade route between Babylon and Ecbatana, carved on the side of the mountain by Darius the Great, is a massive rock carving at Behistun. The inscriptions were carved in three languages, Akkadian, Edomite, and Old Persian. They all told the same story. This is a sketch of the paneling made in the 19th century. They show that the Babylonian Akkadian name of Gimira was written Saka on the Persian inscription, proving that the Gimira and the Saka were the same people. On one of the carvings ordered to be done by Darius, he boasts of his capture of some of these Saka. Evidently, it was an event worth recording. And the Saka prisoners are shown wearing tall conical hats, found at a later date in the tombs of the Goths and Scythians in Eastern Europe. Not all Israel migrated westward, preserved in the permafrost of southeast Russia and southern Siberia. Mummified bodies in frozen tombs have been found by the archaeologists, showing unmistakable Caucasian features. These bodies have been carbon dated to the exact period when Israel was migrating away from Assyria and Media. One group, identified as the Massagetae, moved northeast into the very area where the bodies were found. These well-preserved corpses not only had Caucasian features, but they were mostly blonde with long noses, deep-set eyes, and were long-skulled. Near the town of Sebaste, at an archaeological site, dated to the 5th century B.C., the body of a woman wearing a conical cap was found, similar to those worn by the Saka prisoners on the Behistun rock face. Excavated from Scythian tombs north of the Caucasus Mountains have been found superbly fashioned gold work, showing in fine detail lifelike portraits of some Scythians, descendants of the Hebrew Israelites. Here are two Scythians mounted on their hardy ponies. Fighting back to back, Scythians using the longbow, reminding us of the little tribe of Benjamin that had 280,000 men of valor that bare shields and drew the bow. But it was not always fighting. They were cattle raisers and farmers, and here a ewe is being milked. Scenes from everyday life are depicted on this gold vase. Here an archer is stringing his bow in exactly the same way that a modern archer does it. Here a warrior is binding up a friend's wounded leg. Scythians got toothache just like everybody else. This looks like a tooth pulling, epony without anesthetic. Here's a superbly fashioned ceremonial comb with a finely detailed scene of activity at the top. The Scythians, like their Celtic descendants, had a love of animals and crafted here as a mythical antelope. They gave it a curvilineal mane, also in later Celtic fashion. Horses played a major part in the life of the Scythian, as they did in the opening up of the American West. This superb workmanship shows us just how the migrating people of Israel looked. Now to get back to the tracing of the lost tribes of Israel, so-called. Under mounting pressure from the Medes and Persians, these Scythians, the eastern branch of the Israel people, moved northwest, coming into contact with a western group, the Cimmerians, also Israel, who had settled for a time in the Carpathian region. But their original kinship, lost during the ensuing centuries, inevitably brought on battles between the two groups. Urged on northwest by the Scythians, the Cimmerians started a slow migration through Central Europe with their wagon trains, sheep, and cattle. They might have resembled a great American westward trek. Their settlements became known to historians as the Hallstatt and Latane cultures. Around 300 BC, the Scythians were in their turn pushed out of the area by a non-Israelitish people, the Sarmatians. And like the Cimmerians, the Scythians also migrated slowly northwestward along the river valleys of the Dnieper, Don, and Danube, following the setting sun toward new lands they were not even aware of on the coastlands and islands of northwest Europe and the Baltic Sea. As they reached these northern coastlands, they settled in scattered groups, possibly in some instances, into their original tribal families. Although called Germanic tribes by the Romans, they were so called so as not to confuse them with the Sarmatians, who now occupied Scythia. The Romans named them Germani, from the Latin word genuine. We know them today as Angles, Saxons, Jutes, Danes, and Vikings. The Celts, for the most part, moved across France and Belgium into Britain to form the bedrock of the British race. Some remained in France to be known as Gauls. Some went as far south as Spain to be known as Iberians, the Gaelic name for Hebrews. Spain today is known as the Iberian Peninsula. Many of the latter migrated into Ireland, where they became known as Scots, so named from their Hebrew ancestors, Skoda. Large numbers of them later crossed over into northern Britain to establish the nation of the Scots in what is now Scotland. One might wonder if any of these migrating Israel people were aware of their ancient origins, that they were descendants from the house of Israel, the Old Testament. The Scots were aware. The Scottish Declaration of Independence, drawn up in 1320 AD, not only contains a record of the origin of the Scots, but tells of their previous migrations. It states that the Scots came to Scotland by way of Scythia 1,200 years after the people of Israel crossed the Red Sea to their new home in the west. Between 450 and 600 AD, the Angles and Saxons from the continent merged together and moved across the English Channel into southeast England. Many taken English wives, merging into the Celtic nation. Angles, Saxons, Jutes, Danes, and Vikings, all one family, but with different names. Vikings from Norway and Denmark and from the Baltic coast moved south into France and became known as Norsemen or Normans, who under William of Normandy, or William the Conqueror, invaded southeast England, thus mixing Norse blood with the Anglo-Celtic, to the latter good of the British race. Our Pilgrim Fathers knew very well that they were of Israel. They called themselves the seed of Abraham, God's servants, the children of Jacob, and his chosen. Today, the world has its eye on America. Centuries ago, the Pilgrim Fathers spoke deliberately of the future destiny of Israel-America. Thomas Jefferson concluded his second inaugural address with these words, "I shall need the favor of that being in whose hands we are, who led our fathers of Israel of old from their native land and planted them in a land flowing with all the necessities and comforts of life." Benjamin Franklin and many other men who founded our nation believed that God was intimately involved in the events of American history, that divine providence was the force that moved the people of the United States to liberty. They founded this nation as a Christian nation. They based their laws on biblical law. However, like our Israel ancestors, we have turned away from God's laws, allowed the liberal ungodly in our midst to occupy the seats of authority, to enslave us in a corrupt financial system, to use our children as pawns in a series of socialistic programs, teaching immorality as an acceptable way of life. We are Jacob Israel, of whom God said, I shall be the God of all the families of Israel, and they shall be my people. So in spite of our unrighteousness and national rejection of him, we're not being cast off, but we are being chastised. We who are Caucasians are Abraham's children, heirs of the promise of God, who said, as long as the sun, moon, and stars exist, so will the descendants of Abraham continue as a nation before me. We should thank Almighty God that we are a nation created for his divine purposes.